Wednesday evening prayer meeting here, April 1st, what is known as April Fool's Day. The fool has said in his heart there is no God, and we are no fool who worship him as our creator and redeemer. We're going to start out this evening with a song, I Am Resolved No Longer to Linger, Charmed by the World's Delights, number 288, I Am Resolved.
I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delights. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have a Lord my side. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior, faithful and true each day. Heed what he saith, do what he will, he is the living way. I will hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
All right, Lauren's going to come and sing for us, God Sees the Heart.
Does not know our Father knows our thoughts, he understands.
far as announcements goes today, we are not meeting collectively here together except for our family. And so I would ask you at the end of the service here just to take time and consider some prayer requests and bring them before the Lord. This is our midweek prayer meeting, and so I would just encourage that if you would just have a quiet time with the Lord. Please remember the Valancourt family with the loss of their Uncle Roger. Just pray for Brother Doug and his family at this time. Pray for those who have pre-existing health conditions within our community, within our church especially. Pray for those who are elderly amongst us that are more susceptible to this coronavirus going around. Ask you lift up our church members who are more further on in age and just more susceptible. The Lord would put his hand upon them, as well as the officials and frontline workers here within our community, within the state and the country. Thank the Lord for our leadership and pray that they will have wisdom and that they will be guided by solid intel as well as spiritual, biblical knowledge as well. I just pray for that. Some of you have been wondering about tithes and offerings, and so I would say at this point you could mail them in to LaGrange Baptist Church, 1370 North State Road 9, LaGrange, Indiana 46761. If you'd like to mail them in, that would be fine. We are working on an online platform so that we can make it a little bit easier here within this time that we don't know how long it's going to be. It just seems to be projected to be longer and longer, but the Lord knows. Pray that he will, that the people will come to him in this time, and that the gospel will be furthered because of this time of insecurity and uncertainty. Take your Bibles tonight, if you will, and we will turn back to Proverbs chapter 3. We've been going verse by verse through Proverbs chapter 3 here, and we are down to verses 11 and 12. Last week we had 9 and 10, honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. This week, looking at the next two verses, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we look to you for a stability in this time. Lord, I pray that you would be with each one who would normally be here tonight, gathered together, praying in unity. And I pray that you would give us a unity of spirit as we're in our different places, in the different homes. And Lord, I pray that you would gather us together. The church is a body, thy body, and not this physical building of wood, and gyprock, and paint. And so, Lord, we look to you for the unity that you can give us in this time, and pray that you would bless each one. In Jesus' name, amen. As a teen, I had many strong opinions about discipline, about child rearing, as I firmly believed that too much was required of me. Naturally speaking, too much was required of me. I mean, I was a good kid, wasn't I? And then, of course, as I looked around and saw the behavior of those around me, there should have been more restrictions upon those who I rubbed shoulders with or those who were disrespectful to me, more correction, more discipline in their lives. Of course, that's the selfish way of looking at it. I'm being a little facetious. I mean, really, did my parents think I was so rebellious that I needed all this oversight? Did they think that these restrictions were needed that I didn't agree with? Well, of course they did. And I did need all this oversight. Didn't matter what my opinion was. They were responsible for my upbringing. Opinions are, my opinion as a child is based upon my feelings and not upon truth, not upon fact. And so it's funny how we see the pendulum swing the other way when we become parents. The pendulum swings to the other side, and obviously there are some things that we do differently than what our parents did, but because of circumstances, not necessarily better than our parents, but just a little bit different. But the pendulum swings from the perspective of the child to the perspective of the parent. And all of a sudden, these boundaries that as a child I thought were unimportant and useless and restricting, now I see as a parent that they are necessary. These social boundaries and these fences that restrict friendships and allow closer friendships, and these restrictions on entertainment and such things in our lives. We have guardrails and hedges that we view as parents that we didn't see the same as children. Because as parents, we see that we are fully responsible to get our children to the place where, as one person put it this week, until they grow a brain. We need to get them to the place where they make rational decisions, and it's not all about fun, and it's not all about freedom, and it's not all about breaking the bonds, and someday when I can be an adult and nobody can boss me. I'm 41, and I've not reached that day yet where nobody can boss me. In fact, I am bound to listen to more people today than I ever was before. I remember my mom sitting me down when I was a young boy, and I was having a hard time with all these rules, and I was having a hard time with what I considered the binding restrictions. And she told me about a friend that she had when she was a little girl. This friend was over to her house one day, and they both went to her mom, and asked if they could do something. And her mom said, no. No, you can't do this. And so my mom, who was a little girl, turned around in disgust to see her friend had a smile on her face. And she said, to my mom's perplexity, I wish my parents loved me enough to say no. Loved you enough to say no? What are you talking about? That doesn't make sense. They say no because they don't love us. And this little girl saw something in her friend's mom called love because she said no. This little girl said, it's like my parents don't care. They never say no. It's like they don't care who I'm with or what I do or where I go or how I behave. It's like they don't even care if I exist. They never say no to me. You know, as a little boy, that really didn't have the desired effect that my mom maybe wanted it to have, because it wasn't a comforting story to me at that time. But today, it's a little bit different. It has an effect on me. I look at rules differently. I look at commandments differently, statutes and judgments. And the Lord says here in Proverbs chapter 3, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. Chastening is discipline. Chastening is the consequences of my disobedience. Chastening is the wages of my sin. Correction is the instruction that I receive due to ignorance. Not that I'm intentionally going against the proper way. It's just that I am, due to ignorance, going the wrong way, and so I'm corrected. You know, it's easy to get discouraged with either one, chastening and correction. It's easy to view it as if God just doesn't love me. God never lets me win. God never lets me have it my way. I'm never good enough. The natural thing for us is to look, as we read these verses, to hone in on the words chastening and correction. But we completely miss the object of what God is trying to say to us. The first thing the Lord says is, "My son. My son." The Father deals with us as children. That is the focus of these verses. That is what we're supposed to hone in on. My son. Not the chastening, not the correction. He's dealing with us as sons. We have a personal relationship. And the New Testament apostle, I believe is the apostle Paul, further develops that thought in Hebrews chapter 12, if you want to turn there. Hebrews chapter 12, where the first three verses are admonishing us to look at Jesus, the author and finisher, to consider him who endured. He was the Son of God. He is the one who we are to look after and look to as the one that was perfect. We're to look at the way he endured suffering and his chastening of the cross, the suffering that he didn't deserve. You know, we deserve our own suffering. That's something we deserve, what we receive. But he endured the contradictions of sinners against himself and did not become faint and weary. And then he says to us, in reference to these verses in Proverbs, verses 5 and forward, "Ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children." As unto children. "My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son he receiveth." This is what we're supposed to be looking at, the fact that we have a relationship as sons and daughters of God, as children of God. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. "For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards, or not part of the family, no longer children, welcome, and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness." You know, we have a phenomenon going on within our nation today and possibly around the world, but especially here within America, North America, and that is that we parents do not treat our children as children. We rather treat them as equals. There's many reasons for that. Some parents are just plain lazy. Don't want to take the time to create rules, family rules, and enforce them. It takes time. It takes commitment. Some cave due to peer pressure within their lives. They feel that because those around, whether it be at school or someplace else, the workplace might think poorly of them if they don't cave into the popular opinion of the day. Follow the experts, if you will. And then there's some who fear repercussions of being reported or taken to court or some other issue if they get serious with child discipline. Whatever the reason, the result is the same. The result is the same. And that is, we see a generation of emerging snowflakes, if you will, that esteem nothing quite so valuable as their own opinion. cry out for safe places whenever they come up upon any opposition or someone disagrees. You know, it's not completely their fault. For the first 15 to 20 years of their lives, they've been allowed to do whatever they want. They've been allowed to play and have no responsibility and receive no resistance and receive no correction and receive no discipline or responsibility. They get to play video games half of the day and half of the night. Is it any surprise that the next 20 years they expect to be able to do the same? No correction. Folks, the trees that experience strong winds and resistance grow to withstand the storm. Bring up a child with no discipline or responsibility, and he is bound to melt under heat or pressure. We see just this sort of character in one of the sons of David. Probably David was completely consumed with being a king, running the country, and all the battles and wars that he was so involved in, and the duties that he saw rearing of his children as a secondary thing. I'm conjecturing here, but many of his sons turned out with very little character compared to their war.